So, in the last episode of this multi-episode series exploring the fall and rise of Final Fantasy XIV in China, I talked about how the Final Fantasy XIV 2.0 launch in China was a surprising disaster. And we left off by talking about the first FanFest that took place in China in 2015, where Yoshi-P was on site to present the Heaven's Ward trailer. But despite some of the positive at the FanFest covered in the first episode, the player base continued to dwindle, and negative feedback continued to pile on about the game in China. And just when you thought things cannot get any worse for Final Fantasy XIV's launch in China, well, Shanta, the Chinese publisher, made a big mistake. On 30th of October 2014, 1 month after the first ever FanFest in China, where there's a bit more of a positive vibe, Shanta stripped the fat chocobo mount that came along with the onshore China's collector's edition, and then listed it in the mock shop equivalent as an individual purchase at the price of $140. To make matters worse, the promotion material, as you can see here, actually mentioned an original price of 998 yuan in small print, which is then struck off to mean that you are getting a discount. But the 998 yuan actually referred to the entire cost of buying the collector's edition and the free chocobo mount previously. It wasn't just for the mount itself. This practice by Shanta, according to my research, is actually pretty common practice amongst the free-to-play games in China. However, thinking the same approach can be applied to Final Fantasy XIV was clearly a huge mistake, and the fans revolted. What remains of the Final Fantasy XIV 2.0 players were outraged. And remember, they launched in China with Final Fantasy 2.0. They did not even launch 1.0. So these outraged fans, what was remaining of them, sent strong letters of complaint directly to Square Enix in Japan. And many of these complaints outlined what they felt were despicable actions taken by Shanta. And facing immense backlash, Shanta, the Chinese publisher for Final Fantasy XIV onshore, quickly made the change on their end, and they announced that they will allow players to obtain the fat chocobo mount as long as they cross 30 hours of in-game time. Yes, this is literally going from one end of the spectrum to the other, trying to make a quick buck off the mount versus suddenly making it free. At this point in time, you are starting to see a pattern. It seems that misjudgment of what players want was a common recurring theme. And in the case of the fat chocobo mount, well, at least it was a misjudgment they can recover from by simply giving it away. However, according to Kafka, the official Chinese producer for Final Fantasy XIV and Shanta, there were many other costly misjudgments that was not reversible in the early days. Kafka said of all these misjudgments, the biggest error was actually the misunderstanding of the product itself. Kafka recollects that initially during the Chinese closed beta, there was huge demand for the closed beta Final Fantasy XIV keys. In fact, Shanta actually set the price of the closed beta keys to be at $6, and this really served to limit the demand and strain on the system and infrastructure. Even though the common practice for Chinese game operators is to simply give away closed beta keys for free, yet despite having to pay $6 for the closed beta keys, within just 10 seconds of putting them up for sale, they were all instantly bought up. And everyone was begging the Shanta publishing team for more of such beta keys. This is another example of misjudgment of the product itself in terms of its demand. Fast forward to launch, Kafka shared from his perspective that the launch was explosive. And initially they had 3 big data centers serving 30 dedicated servers in China. And from what I understand, the data centers work similarly to how we have it in the rest of the world. If you play on data center A, serving servers 1 to 10, you can't play with people from data center B that serve servers 11 to 20. Due to the very strong demand, Shanta decided to quickly expand to 4 big data centers that will now serve a total of 40 dedicated servers. In fact, the post you see to the right is what they actually announced on Weibo, one of the biggest Chinese social platforms, about the server expansion. Now, the thinking here is that the traditional game operation mentality in China is to first focus on user growth at launch. More of a do first and then we'll consider the consequences later kind of approach. And the mentality back then was that Final Fantasy XIV was such a strong IP. Plus, Final Fantasy XIV 2.0 was doing very well on the Western world, so no one had any doubts about making such drastic and costly changes. No one actually predicted that FF14 might fail in China. Any concerns about core gameplay issues and experience were neglected, as they felt that this can be compensated by Shanta simply running local operations and marketing efforts properly. But obviously, if you watched the first episode, you knew they were dead wrong. The player numbers plummeted so quickly due to reasons explained in the first episode, mostly related to mismatch and user expectation of gameplay experiences. The plummet was so swift that Kafka and his team was unable to even deploy additional money or marketing dollars to remedy the situation. And fast forward to December 2014, 3 months after the FanFest in China, Shanda announced server transfers, hopefully as a means to optimize their server loads. Because if you recall, they expanded servers so quickly to meet the initial surge in demand, only to have the player base drop significantly. However, more problems await them. By the second week of introducing server transfers, problems are starting to arise, as more and more players flock to the popular servers to play with the most active population base. A huge number of low population servers became absolute ghost towns. Some Chinese forum posts summed it up the best. Amongst his 300 acquaintances on his list, only 7 people remained on the original server, the rest all transferred to the high population servers at that point in time. The biggest takeaway for Kafka, the Chinese producer for Final Fantasy XIV, is that you shouldn't focus on bottom line or revenues, but focus on making sure there's optimal operations when it comes to running the game. Another huge lesson for Kafka and his team is that Final Fantasy XIV is indeed a unique game. At its core, Final Fantasy XIV is an authentic JRPG, but it also infuses elements from other Western MMOs, which I personally guess is due to Yoshi-P's own experience of playing and admiring Western games when growing up. This also meant that it was erroneous to run Final Fantasy XIV in China the exact same way a game publisher would have ran other traditional MMORPGs, because Final Fantasy XIV is different. Shanda obviously learned this the hard way. The company failed to take all these little nuances of Final Fantasy XIV into consideration, and it's these little nuances that precisely made it a foreign experience to China players at that point in time. And naturally, when the Chinese gamers are still in the phase of adapting to these new MMORPG experiences and mechanisms, Shanda over-aggressively tried to monetize them via things like the Fat Chocobo campaign, and that naturally caused the situation to implode. The point that they did not take the nuances into account was further reinforced in a later analysis and study of its user feedback. 50 to 60% of the respondents actually said that Final Fantasy XIV is their first ever Final Fantasy game. And amongst these group of people, there was even a subset of people who saw Final Fantasy XIV as their first ever MMORPG. Kafka, the Chinese producer of the game, recalls that soon after there was a big company meeting within Shanda. Someone stood up and posed a direct question to the management of Shanda, saying that since Final Fantasy XIV has failed, will the company still look to bring in other IPs and games? And Kafka said he recalled hanging his head down speechless. He never expected people to give up on the game so quickly, and he only had three questions in mind. How can he stage a comeback for Final Fantasy XIV in China? What campaigns can he run that fits the target audience of the game? And how does he operate the game optimally in China? And that, my friend, wraps up a pretty sad episode 2. But make sure to smash that subscribe button down below to stay notified, because in the next episode, you will see us discussing the incredible turnaround story and the start of the comeback of Final Fantasy XIV in China. You definitely don't want to miss that. A shout out to my Patreon subscribers, and thanks for watching the video. I'll see you in the next episode.